from Simon & Schuster Audio. Wait till next year. Recollections of a 50s Girlhood. Written and read by Doris Kearns Goodwin.
When I was six, my father gave me a bright red scorebook that opened my heart to the game of baseball. After dinner on long summer nights, he would sit beside me in our small enclosed porch to hear my account of that day's Brooklyn Dodger game. Night after night, he taught me the odd collection of symbols, numbers, and letters that enable a baseball lover to record every action of the game. Our score sheets had blank boxes in which we could draw our own slanted lines in the form of a diamond as we followed players around the bases. Wherever the base runner's progress stopped, the line stopped. He instructed me to fill in the unused boxes at the end of each inning with an elaborate checkerboard design which made it absolutely clear who had been the last to bat and who would lead off the next inning. By the time I had mastered the art of scorekeeping, a lasting bond had been forged among my father, baseball, and me. All through the summer of 1949, my first summer as a fan, I spent my afternoon sitting cross-legged before the squat Philco radio, which stood as a permanent fixture on our porch in Rockville Center on the south shore of Long Island, New York. With my scorebook spread before me, I attended Dodger games through the courtly voice of Dodger announcer Red Barber. As he announced the lineup, I carefully printed each player's name in a column on the left side of my sheet. Then, using the standard system my father had taught me, I recorded every play. I found it difficult at times to sit still. As the Dodgers came to bat, I would walk around the room, talking to the players as if they were standing in front of me. At critical junctures, I tried to make a bargain, whispering and cajoling while Pee Wee Reese or Duke Snider stepped into the batter's box. "Please, please get a hit. If you get a hit now, I'll make my bed every day for a week." Sometimes, when the score was close and the opposing team at bat with men on base, I was too agitated to listen. Asking my mother to keep score, I left the house for a walk around the block, hoping that when I returned, the enemy threat would be over and once again we'd be up at bat. Mostly, however, I stayed at my post, diligently recording every inning, so that when my father returned from his job as bank examiner for the state of New York, I could recreate for him the game he had missed. When my father came home from the city, he would change from his three-piece suit into long pants and a short-sleeved sport shirt and come downstairs for the ritual Manhattan cocktail with my mother. Then my parents would summon me for dinner from my play on the street outside our house. All through dinner, I had to restrain myself from telling him about the day's game, waiting for the special time to come when we would sit together on the couch, my scorebook on my lap. "Well, did anything interesting happen today?" he would begin. And even before the daily question was completed, I had eagerly launched into my narrative of every play and almost every pitch of that afternoon's contest. It never crossed my mind to wonder if, at close of a day's work, he might find my lengthy account the least bit tedious. For there was mastery as well as pleasure in our nightly ritual. Through my knowledge, I commanded my father's undivided attention, the sign of his love. It would instill in me an early awareness of the power of narrative, which would introduce a lifetime of incessant storytelling, fueled by the perhaps naive confidence that others would find me as entertaining as my father did. Michael Francis Aloysius Kearns, my father, was a short man who appeared much larger on account of his erect bearing, broad chest, and thick neck. He had a ruddy Irish complexion, and his green eyes flashed with humor and vitality. When he smiled, his entire face was transformed, radiating enthusiasm and friendliness. He called me Bubbles, a pet name he had chosen, he told me, because I seemed to enjoy so many things. Anxious to confirm his description, I refused to let my enthusiasm wane, even when I grew tired or grumpy. Thus, excitement about things became a habit, a part of my personality, and the expectation that I should enjoy new experiences often engendered the enjoyment itself. These nightly recountings of the Dodgers' progress provided my first lessons in the narrative art. At first, I was unable to resist the temptation to skip ahead to an important play in later innings. At times, I grew so excited about a Dodger victory that I blurted out the final score before I had hardly begun. But as I became more experienced in my storytelling, I learned to build a dramatic story with a beginning, middle, and end. Slowly, I learned that if I could recount the game, one batter at a time, inning by inning, without divulging the outcome, I could keep the suspense and my father's interest alive until the very last pitch. When I had finished describing the game, it was time to go to bed, unless I could convince my father to tally each player's batting average, reconfiguring his statistics to reflect the developments of that day's game. If, for example, Reese went 3 for 5 and had started the day at 303, my father showed me, by adding and multiplying all the numbers in his head, that his average would rise to 305. If Carl Erskine had let in 3 runs in 7 innings, then my father would multiply 3 times 9, divide that by the number of innings pitched, and magically tell me whether Erskine's earned run average had grown or shrunk. It was this facility with numbers that had made it possible for my father to pass the civil service test and become a bank examiner, despite leaving school after the 8th grade, a job which had carried him from a Brooklyn tenement to a house with a lawn on Southard Avenue in Rockville Center. All through that summer, my father kept from me the knowledge that running box scores appeared in the daily newspapers. He never mentioned that these abbreviated histories had been a staple feature of the sports pages since the 19th century and were generally the first thing he and his fellow commuters turned to when they opened the Daily News and the Herald Tribune in the morning. I believed that if I did not recount the games he had missed, my father would never have been able to follow our Dodgers the proper way, day by day, play by play, inning by inning. In other words, without me, his love of baseball would be forever unfulfilled. When I picture my mother, Helen, she is sitting in her favorite cushioned chair, and she is reading. She was slim and tall, several inches taller than my father. Her hair, primly curled with the soft waves of a permanent, was brown, touched with gray. She never wore shorts or even slacks. In the grip of the worst heat waves, she wore a girdle, a full slip, and a cotton or linen dress with a bib apron perpetually fixed to her shoulders. Such modesty was the norm in our neighborhood. Indeed, when one of the mothers took to sitting on her front lawn in a halter top and shorts, her behavior startled the block. My mother had a long face, conspicuously marked by the deep creases and the furrowed brow of a woman twice her age. When she was in her 30s, she was told by her doctor that she had the arteries of a 70-year-old. Shortly after I was born, she had undergone a hysterectomy after being diagnosed with cancer. Though it turned out that she did not have cancer, the removal of her ovaries and her uterus had precipitated a surgical menopause, which, in those days before hormone replacement, rapidly escalated the aging process. In addition, the rheumatic fever she had suffered as a child had left her heart permanently scarred. When I was 2, she began having angina attacks 6 or 8 times a year, episodes characterized by severe pain on her left side and a temporary loss of consciousness. All we could do, the doctors told us, was break smelling salts under her nose to restore consciousness and leave her on the floor until the pain subsided, which sometimes took several hours. I can still remember the chill I felt from a place so deep within me that my entire body started to tremble when I first saw her stretched out on the floor, a pillow under her head, a blanket over her body. My father assured me that everything would be all right and said I could sit beside her for a little while and hold her hand. After these, quote, spells, as we euphemistically called them, she would quickly resume her household routine, allowing us to imagine that all was well again. In our family album, there was a photo of my mother in her early 20s, sitting in a chair in her parents' home, her long legs thrown casually over the arm of the chair, her lips parted in the beginning of a smile. 20 years after that photo was taken, there was in her halting gait and nervous expression scarcely a trace of her former vitality and charm. I used to stare at that picture and try to imagine the high-spirited person she was before I was born, wishing that I could transport myself back in time to meet the young Helen Miller. Every night I would fall asleep with the prayer that while I slept, the lines on my mother's face would vanish, the leg that now dragged behind her would strengthen, her skin would lose its pallor. During my waking hours, when seated alone, I would daydream, allowing my imagination to reshape those realities I did not wish to accept. In my fantasy, my mother would appear as the young woman in the photo, wearing a summer dress with a ribbon in her hair. She was no longer short of breath. She could run and skip and dance. All my neighbors were crowded together on our lawn to watch my mother jump rope. My friend Eileen Rust and I each held one handle of the striped rope while my mother counted aloud the number.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.